My name is JT Van Zandt. I'm a fly fishing guide on the Gulf Coast of Texas. Being on the water has always been the secret to unlocking my soul. I just feel like I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing in this life. And that feeling inspires deep thought and conversations with my clients, who are all of varied backgrounds. I truly enjoy sharing perspective on the human experience with folks I take fishing. Drifting, a YETI Presents podcast, was created with the goal of capturing those candid conversations with people who inspire me and sharing them with an audience that has the same sort of restlessness and curiosity that I do. I have found that the best way to provide wisdom and hope for future generations is to learn from the folks that have blazed the trail before us and have made tough decisions in the pursuit of living an extraordinary life. I hope you enjoy, and thanks for listening to Drifting. Terry Allen is an American artist and songwriter from Lubbock, Texas. His sculptures and paintings are celebrated throughout the art community in high regard. His songs, their words, and melody are so unique and so intricate that he really can't be compared to any other musical artist from Texas or elsewhere. Artistically, he cannot be categorized as anything but Terry. Terry was a close friend to Guy Clark and to my father, and I grew up with his sons. I hung out with Terry recently in a Nashville hotel room. It was great catching up with him because I hadn't seen him since Guy had passed. He discussed his latest sculpture, which was infused with Guy's ashes, a request that Guy had left in his will and that Terry honored. I asked how he developed his musical style, and he talked about his mom, who was a barrel house piano player. Terry finds no distinction between his paintings, sculptures, or songs. They're all just his interpretation of life, and if you let his art into your head, it will forever be there, carving its own channels in your mind. It's good to spend time with you too, Terry.
Yeah, same here, JT, always.
How did you stay out of all the bullshit? And like, it seems to me that family was always like, you weren't out there burning it from all ends, were you?
Well, I was in a sense, but I went to California. And I went to art school, and that was my first introduction into kind of trying to find what I was. And and it was during the 60s, early 60s, so a lot of things were happening from a lot of different directions. The whole music was changing radically. Dylan, it appeared. The war was going on, which was a huge issue. Just the arts were changing because they were kind of collapsing. These labels were collapsing and kind of running into one another. All these different genres and things that we call genre were working together. Sculptors were working with musicians. Dancers were working with painters. Just this kind of merging that was going on. But everything was breaking loose, kind of. And because of the war, too, I think that music became one of the most volatile art forms. And because it was addressing the same people that were resisting the war were listening to the same music that the people that were fighting the war. And so music became a huge kind of fulcrum, you know, for what was happening in the world. And so I was embroiled in that in L.A., the art school that I went to. Right after I got out of school, I taught in Watts, taught the third grade in Watts, because they had the first Watts riots was in 65, and all of these teachers had quit, mostly white teachers, but most of their teachers, period, quit. And so in the U.S. poverty program, they hired all these young people to come and kind of opened up this teaching in Watts, and I ended up in the with a third grade class with like 40 kids. I think you had to have pass a test, and then I had 2 weeks crash indoctrination and found myself in Watts in one of the poorest schools there teaching 40 kids. And that was like a huge education for me, because I never experienced that kind of poverty, that kind of incredible generosity. It's one of those schools where that people raised canned goods and money for the poor, and they were the poorest of the poor, yet they, you know, brought in all of this, all of these canned goods and money and stuff. So
this was right after art school?
Yeah, this was a year after art school. And also, it served, you know, I ended up being deferred from the draft too, which was a huge issue. But I was also married, and I was also a little older than kind of, so I was way back kind of on the list. And then Buck was born the day that job ended. So I'm just lucky, just really lucky as far as
what was the deferment about?
It was because the teaching was on the U.S. poverty program.
I gotcha. And good deal.
And so they you were kind of exempt. And the day that ended, you know, I was going to be reclassified, but then Bucket was born. So, you know, I never was in that lottery way up. Always had a, you know, I always had a high number instead of a low number.
So. And the war was kind of a boiling point on top of the civil rights movement, the sexual revolution, like so
yeah,
much was happening.
I think everything was happening kind of at once in the 60s. And so it's incredibly exciting, incredibly depressing, incredibly all things kind of, you know. And to be in L.A. at that time was, we were exposed to so many different kind of all the arts and whatever, you know, just by the nature of the times, I think, you know. So in that sense, you know, I didn't go from Lubbock to Austin. I didn't think in terms of like I was going to be a songwriter. Or I was going to be the, I started writing songs in the 60s. And I wrote songs. I got kicked out of high school for writing a song. I wrote, and there was a musician named David Box who was in Lubbock at the time. And David actually was the first singer that took Buddy Holly's place with the Crickets after Buddy Holly was killed. And he recorded one record with them, Peggy Sue Got Married, and I forget what the flip side was. But anyway, David and I were in high school together, and we tried out with like a Bo Diddley song. When it came our turn to made this assembly, this talent show assembly at Monterey. But by the time when we went on to play, we put on togas and went out and sang my song, which was called The Roman Orgy. And much to the delight of all of our peers, you know, but really pissed the powers that be off. And we both got thrown out of school. For like, David never came back. I was out for like 3 or 4 days and then, you know, came back.
What grade?
But we were seniors in high school. And and David eventually, actually, when he was hustling, he was flying around trying to promote his song, was killed in a plane crash going to Fort Worth from Lubbock to, you know, promote this record.
Oh.
So...
the piano keys, no
yeah,
less.
Right.
I would have won money on that.
Yeah, I'm just going to turn it off. How about that?
That'll work.
I should put it on airplane mode.
This is a casual affair, so yeah. No worries there.
Yeah, sorry.
No, not at all.
Let's see.
Even as a Texan, I got no guess as to what growing up out west would be like.
Yeah.
And I imagine you get tight with your family and everything you see and do becomes familiar, and it's no different from any other childhood. But as you become an adult, you're kind of in a cage without any boundaries out there.
Yeah.
You're in a batting cage as to who you are.
I think it happened a little earlier than that for me because my folks were, my dad was 60 when I was born. My mother was 40, which was old for a woman at that time. And it was, in a way, they'd been through their lives. And some aspects of their lives were collapsing pretty heavy for them.
Like what?
Oh, like there was a lot of alcoholism on my mother's side and then my father died when I was pretty young. So everything kind of busted loose for me when I was a teenager, which is, you know, bust loose for everybody pretty much when they're teenagers. But that had an effect on I'm sure on, you know, choices that you make and whatever. But it was one of those things where I did my best in my mind to kind of escape it and put it in some kind of place I didn't want to deal. I didn't want to go home. But at the same time, I felt responsible and all of that. You know, I think like a lot of people that are around those kind of situations feel. You know, so it's always a kind of a schizophrenia that you develop, you know, or at least a paradox. So I was ready to leave by the time, you know, I got out of high school. But it's like Bale, my youngest son, you know, I didn't want to be anything. All these people I knew wanted to be, they had plans of where they're going to college, what they were going to do, and they wanted to be lawyers. And I remember asking Bale once when he was a little kid, you know, well, what do you want to be when you grow up? And he said, I want to be a horse, you know. And I felt kind of like that. I felt like, you know, it's Martian, you know, because I don't really know what I want to be, and I don't relate
to, hear you say
to
that.
Being something, you know. I always loved to draw. So I remember I had a teacher in high school that Ms. Murphy, and it was sophomore in high school, and it's when the beatnik rage had kind of hit Lubbock, which was the whole other astounding story, like the beatnik rage in Lubbock. But it was when everybody was, you know, starting to wear berets and the girls were wearing leotards and everybody wearing sunglasses at night. And there was always a saxophone and somebody doing a poem or whatever. So I was caught up, man. I'd read Kerouac and all that and got really excited about that. You know, that whole idea of bohemia and life. But we were studying Shakespeare, and we were all in the class supposed to be reading from the book. And it was Julius Caesar, and our teacher, Ms. Murphy, was at the front of the class, and she was, you know, reading it, and we were supposed to be following her. And I was writing this beatnik poem, which was, you know, I'm sure just the most ridiculous kind of, you know, vomit, you know. But anyway, so she stops the class and she said, you read, you stand up and read what you're writing. And I thought, oh, shit, you know, I'm dead, you know. So I stood up and I read this gibberish, god-awful gibberish. And she looked at me really serious and she said, you keep doing that, you know. And that was one of those moments where you got a permission that you weren't expecting, you know, and which was huge for me at the time, because I have obviously haven't forgotten it, you know. And then I remember another.
It's a lot more likely story to have been scolded in that instance, isn't it?
Yeah, I would be thrown out again. I was so used to kind of being sent to the principal or, you know, being in some kind of a jam with. Like I was thrown out of school again another time for doing porno drawings on people's notebooks for 25 cents, you know, and that's a pick up lunch money and stuff, you know. So the irony to me has always been the two things I got kicked out of high school for were the two things I ended up basically living my life doing, you know.
Did you have a lot of friends in school growing up in Lubbock? Or were you an outsider?
I had some close friends, but I didn't have a lot of friends, you know.
You weren't Mr. Social?
No, I wasn't. I didn't. I was Mr. Confused pretty much, you know, I think.
Did you walk the streets of town?
I'm not sure that everybody wasn't.
I
drove around a lot at night, and a few friends that I had that were in the same kind of mental predicament, you know, we would drive around all night long.
In town or out?
Yeah, in town, out in the country, whatever, and just talk and drink and, you know, and put life totally out of perspective, you know. But, because you didn't want to go home because you didn't have a sense of what you were going into anyway, you know. And, but I think those kind of weird melancholy nights with music, it was always with music, were huge kind of in retrospect.
What was the musical progression for you and your tastes from your early recollection, say early junior high or elementary school, up to a senior in high school? What were you listening to?
Well, the first really huge impact was Elvis, I remember. It was all kind of the hit parade and Coke time and that kind of crap that was on TV and also on the radio. It was that, how much is that doggy in the window kind of time period, you know? And I hadn't ever listened to really big band stuff. And there was country music, because my dad, he was an old ball player, and he had in Lubbock, there was a four square gospel church that went bankrupt. And he got the space and started throwing dances in it. And eventually got the wrestling promotership and started doing wrestling matches, and then moved to an aircraft hangar out at the airport, and they'd have dances on Friday and Saturday night, and Friday night was always all black dances, and they had great people like T-Bone Walker and B.B. King and all these incredible touring bands, which that's what all those. No, it was heavily segregated. But I worked there as a, you know, because I was like, well, it was 48, 49, whatever. I was 6-7 years old when I was, and I worked there for the whole time that, you know, he had this stuff, these shows and stuff. But then on Saturday, it would be like Hank Williams and Ernest Tubb and all of those, the white touring bands became. So I got this incredible education that I had no idea of who these people were or what. And it wasn't obviously until a long time later, I realized what an incredible, fertile environment both of those nights were for me.
Oh, man.
But also the wrestling matches. And he started doing wrestling matches every Wednesday night. And that was kind of the last great public theater, you know, the last great spectacle. So I always tied them, all of that in my mind kind of together, you know.
Was that a sideline gig for your dad? Promote those shows?
No, that was his.
That was his deal.
Yeah, that was, he kind of, when he got too old to play baseball, that's what he did. He always considered himself a ball player, you know, no matter what he did. But he was an incredible entrepreneur and you know, through these dances, through the first Cosmopolitan dance in Lubbock, which was Ray Charles. And first time blacks, whites, and Hispanics were all under the same roof. And I remember Joe Harvey and I went to that. We were like in junior high. And it was like three little knots of people that were so outrageously paranoid of one another, you know, and they were all, everybody was looking at everybody else. But Ray Charles was playing, you know. So
It was
pretty incredible if you think about it. And
commonplace to you guys, those were the artists of the day.
Yeah.
Who have become our greatest American heroes.
And I think that's, you know, I think it was Dylan one time was saying, like, you know, during the radio, you couldn't find a bad song on the radio in those days, you know. And now you can't find a good one, you know. But and the Wolfman Jack was huge. I think all, because during that time, all of the first things that happened to you in your life of importance happened in a car, you know, and it would and had a soundtrack to it in some way. And I remember that loving that thing of late at night, just driving as fast as you could go, listening to that radio as loud as it would go. And it was usually Wolfman Jack, you know. And he always inserted those wolf howls at the perfect place in a song, you know. So, and he played music that you hadn't ever heard before. He played a lot of rhythm and blues that was coming out of the East Coast, played a lot of Southern blues music that you'd never heard. And so that was like one of these kind of incredible gifts every night that when you got in the car, you know, to listen to. And then there was another station, KOMA out of Oklahoma City, that played more white bread kind of music. But one of the great things they did is every night they would give a list of band names that were all through the Midwest and all these venues that they were playing these clubs with. And I wish I had a tape of those names, because they were phenomenal, you know. It's just like the most classic kind of stupid ass band names you could imagine. But all of that stuff, I think that was a kind of environment, you know, that was percolating at the time, you know, that you were percolating in. And so the music was absorbed, in a sense. It wasn't just music you listened to and danced to and whatever. That was there too, but it was like an animal. It was like a creature that became a part of you, I think, you know. So I never thought of it as being something you went out to pursue to make a career or do that, even though, you know, I've done that. But that was never anything that motivated me to, you know. It was more that climate that you were seeking, you know, for yourself and to make something. And that's where, to me, that songs came from. And to a degree still is, you know.
Even though your mom was playing and traveling as a musician, or going outside of town to gig?
She only traveled when I was little. She had pretty much quit. She had this gig in Santa Fe, and so we'd drive from Lubbock on the weekend, and I'd sleep in the booth, and it was in the lounge at the La Fonda Hotel, and she played her gigs, and then we'd leave. And
by herself?
Yeah, it was all solo gig.
Did she sing and play piano?
She didn't sing. She just played. And I've tried to find posters, to go back and find the posters in the late 40s, you know, of her playing, and or just any kind of an announcement of it, and I've never been able to find any there.
Would your dad go to Santa Fe?
No, he never
trips?
Went. He was, you know, he was always off, usually on the weekend. He was dealing with the dances and stuff that were at the, you know, airport or the, you know, the gospel place.
Was he the only promoter of that music in Lubbock?
No, there were other promoters, but he
was getting
it.
Ray Charles and Hank Williams.
He was one of the
first
ones to bring in the rock and roll people. I mean, it was funny. My folks, you know, it was such a conservative environment, but my dad had been he's kind of a local sports hero, you know, because he had played in the Texas League and kind of played on the Lubbock Hubbers and actually helped start that ball club. So he got kind of a free ticket, I think, with all of that, because Lubbock was really bad. I mean, they had record burnings, you know, they had preachers were all telling kids to, or families or their parents to bring, you know, records to the fairground and get rid of this devil's, you know, music. And so they had big bonfires and burnings of records and stuff during that time, which didn't do anything but sell a lot more records, you know. It just enticed everybody to grab them. But my folks were, you know, like he brought Elvis in twice. First time Elvis came right after he had Milk Cow Blues Boogie's first record. And he opened for, I think, Little Jimmy Dickens, you know. And then the next time was after shortly after.
Did you go to did you work at that show?
Yeah, I worked both of those shows. I remember both of those shows.
Was your jaw on your chest?
In fact, I remember Elvis, the first show, coming with the band, stopping at our house and coming, trying to get directions to where the gig was. You know, they had our address for my dad, and so he gave me the directions. But it was that classic thing, the bass on the top of the station wagon, and, you know. And so all of those kind of memories, you know, which were so rich, like in thinking back on them, you know.
Can you remember your dad's response to Elvis's show? Whether he was a fan?
I can't. He wasn't offended by it, you know. My folks were pretty unfazed, you know. Like, my mother had been through a lot of bullshit with SMU and got kicked out of school and
what for?
Worked for playing jazz with a band in Deep Ellum Black Band, which was like unspeakable. She said that's what the dean told her when they kicked her out. She said it was, you know, it's unspeakable for a white girl to play with, you know.
You're out of here.
Negro musicians, you know, and then playing this devil's music, which is jazz. So it kind of, you know, to her telling it, I'm sure it had a huge emotional impact on her, but she went to Fort Worth and became enrolled in beauty school to get a day job, and then worked a band at night. And when she got her certificate, she had to redo it when she went to California, but the whole band went to California, and she played up and down the coast, you know, for years out there, lived out there for a long time, married several times. I have no idea how many times my mother was actually married, you know.
When did she divorce your dad?
She never divorced him. He died.
Gotcha.
They were married, I guess, 16 years, and that was the longest either one of them were with anybody, you know.
Was he out? Did he die before you were out of high school?
Yeah, I was 15 when he died.
That's tough.
Well, it was, you know. It was funny because he was old, and I used to get in a lot of fights when I was a kid because somebody said, you know, like, your dad sure is old. And I'd hit him in the face or something, you know. And I don't know why. I don't know why that would be so offensive, but I was intimidated by it for some reason, you know, or self-conscious about it. And, but, you know, thinking back about it, they were both always incredibly generous to me, you know. Very haunted, my mother was, in a lot of ways, but it took me a long time to realize it wasn't anything about me, you know. It was her haunted. It was something from a lot of other places that was happening. And so, anyway, you know, that's part of the deal.
From the talent show bit, sounded like kind of a slapstick kind of song that you came up with there. Had you already been writing serious music leading up to?
No, I didn't. The first song I wrote that I thought was a real actual song was a song called Red Bird. And it was the first song I wrote not to cause some kind of trouble, you know, that I really thought about it as a song. And I ended up, I was working while I was in school at this, in Hollywood Hills, doing carpentry and just labor work. For these two guys, two gay guys that were building this kind of mansion up in the Hollywood Hills. And so they'd hired students to come and just basic slave labor. And I remember one, they had a piano in their living room, and we were waiting to get our checks one day. They were writing checks in the kitchen. And so I went and sat down at the piano in the living room and started playing. And one of these guys came up and said, "Hey, you want to be on Shindig?" Which was like, you know, big popular rock and roll variety show at the time, like Hullabaloo or whatever. But I said, "Yeah, sure," you know. And he said, "Well, we'll come in and audition." And I went to this little rat hole studio down in on Western Avenue and played about the only two songs I knew, which was Red Bird and another song I'd written called Freedom School. and played them for these, and they said, okay, you got you your own, you know. And I remember down the hall, there was a band that was also trying out, and it was the Birds. It was the first time the Birds had come to L.A. But so I was on Shindig, I guess it was in 64, and I remember Marianne Faithfull was on Little Eva doing Locomotion. There was some English, you know, Beatle ripoff band. And a guy named Jerry Allison, who, not Jerry Allison, I can't remember his last name, but he was from Lubbock. And he said, I'll show you the ropes, you know, and he was kind of a slick pop singer. But he was really nice to me. Everybody was very nice to me. And I remember thinking, you know, so I went on, I played for like a minute and a half, two songs, as fast as I could play them. And Brian Epstein was in the audience sitting behind Joe Harvey, and she said, or that he kind of patted her on the shoulder and said how much he liked it, and he wanted to talk to me after the show and all of this stuff, or next week or whatever. And so we thought, yeah, man, you know, I'm just going to be on TV every week, you know. And so we borrowed about $50 from the guys I worked for, these guys. And the reason I got on is that the guy that said, you want to be on Shindig, was the director. He was one of the directors at Shindig. We took this money and went to the beach and celebrated whatever, and never heard from anybody again, you know. But that was my first step into the, you know, music.
So you learned to play piano as a kid in proximity to your mom and her talent?
Yeah, I think I just learned to play it out of kind of a necessity.
No forced piano lessons or anything like
that? I had piano lessons, but they lasted about 3 weeks, I think. And no, there was nothing forced. It was like, you know, well, you try this, you might like it, that kind of thing. And if you don't, forget it, you know. But we had a piano there. My mother played all the time, and it was always in a party context, usually, you know, where something would bust out and people would come in at the middle of the night or whatever, and a party would break out. And so it was always a background to something that was going on.
You never remember just playing around the house to play?
No, I never remember her doing it.
Yeah.
You know? And that's not to say she didn't do it. I just don't remember her doing it.
Probably when no one was in the house, she walked by and sang out for a minute. Yeah,
because she was a barrel house player, so she played, you know, a lot of boogie woogie and a lot of, you know, hard pounding stuff, and smoked two cigarettes at once while she was stomping on the pedal, and and you know, it was a wonder to watch, you know, and listen to. She was great, really great player. She hated Liberace, I remember, hated his TV show because she thought she could outplay him, you know, but she never missed it, you know.
Yeah. So art was kind of more in your mind than music, really, because you chose an art college.
Well, I went one semester at Texas Tech, and my grades were so bad, and from high school, I barely got into Texas Tech, and I failed everything at Texas Tech except a drawing class and a writing class, which I liked, and I didn't pay any attention really to anything else. But I remember asking the guy in the drawing class if there was a school like his class, you know. And he told me about this school in L.A., and I literally was gone, you know, within 2 or 3 days to California. And I had written them a letter, and I beat the letter there, you know. So I was ready to go, you know. And that was just kind of a vehicle to, but that was the first time I ever was around people that were really cold-blooded serious about making a picture or making anything that they were making, that this wasn't any, you know, a joke. This wasn't any kind of, you know, sub-level behavior. It was like, it was life or death to, you know, to make something. And I'd never been around people that were that committed to like making a line or making a color or making a sound. And so it, I fell into it like just with kind of a great relief, I think. And they had a lot of the academic classes were just 3 hours in the morning. The rest of it, you were in a studio working. But the academic classes were great because, you know, they had really good people that were trying to pick up some extra money that were taught at UCLA or wherever, but really good writers, scientists, people that would just kind of come in. And it I always liked to read, you know, something that had always been important in kind of a closeted way, you know, Lubbock closeted way, because, you know, boys reading books was not, you know, was kind of frowned upon, and unless you were a major football hero or something like that, you know, so you kept it to yourself what you read, you know, and but everything kind of opened up once I got to California, and it's, you know, but it also made me so aware of how restricted where I came from was, and I built kind of an anger about it, about, you know, growing up in that world and how restrictive and uptight everything was and conservative. And of course, then everything was happening, was breaking loose in the 60s too. So it was, everything was counter to it, you know. And I didn't come to terms with that until I went back. I remember I cut Warriors in 74. And then I'd been writing a lot of songs from the late 60s right up through the late 70s. And had the opportunity to do my second record in Lubbock and go back and do it. And it was just kind of a fluke of circumstances. But that's when I went back and I was literally listening to the recordings of those songs on Lubbock on Everything was the first time it dawned on me how much I cared about it, you know, and that somewhere, as much as vocal I was, had been vehemently against Texas and Lubbock and all of that, that there was something else at play that I wasn't even aware of, because the songs were anything but hateful. They were smart ass and kind of sarcastic, I suppose, you know, but they weren't hateful about it. And so that's what we were kind of talking about today, about how you come to terms by leaving, you know, that you never really see a place until you leave it, you know, and come back.
I always saw your songs as celebratory of that place in a real unapologetic way.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is. It does celebrate those people, you know. It celebrates that kind of humanity.
Did your mom follow you out to California? Is that how she got out there? Was she,
well, no, mom? She went out for after my dad died. Then I went to California. She sold the house and went to Palm Springs for like 6 months, and then moved back to Amarillo and lived there until she died, you know, in 84. But we came back and forth a lot because Joe Harvey's folks were in Lubbock, and then my mother was in Amarillo. So.
You mentioned Joe Harvey in junior high.
Yeah.
When did you guys meet and decide that
we
was met, it?
We were in eighth grade. We actually met. Yeah, I was, we were 11 when we met at some party, that, you know, for kids that they had, and we danced at that party. And then ended up going to the same junior high and were friends, but wasn't until high school we became really good friends. Joe Harvey gave me the first LPs I ever got was John Lee Hooker, Traveling. You know, which
Joe Harvey had picked those out.
Yeah, she picked it
and worn them out and passed them on to you.
She knew I loved, you know, John Lee Hooker and Jimmy Reed, and the first record I think I bought was that yellow cover with Little Richard. You know, but I never was a big fan of Well, I was a fan of piano players. I mean, I liked, you know, loved Little Richard, Jimmy Reed, Ray Charles, and all those. I thought they were fun. But I never thought of it in any kind of context of something I could do. What moved me was like Bo Diddley and Chuck Berry and those incredible rhythms, those guitar. And I always thought that I kind of learned to play piano as limited as my learning is by those rhythms, you know. And that I'm much more like a bomb, 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 you know, kind of thing. And then it kind of, whatever I can play came out of that, you know.
When did you start writing songs?
When I was in school. I was in a little blues band called the Blackwall Blues Quintet, which was a, kind of the school, art school band, and we played all the parties and stuff like, but I started writing some for that. We mostly did blues covers and whatever, but really it was probably 65, 66, I started kind of writing steadily, you know. That became, and part of it was because I was trying to come up with these ideas of, I called them paper listening movies, and they were these drawings that I made, and that would tell part of a story, and then I would attach a song, like in those days, reel to reel, I would glue a box with a reel to reel tape on the back with the other part of the story, which was a song. You know, so you got a drawing and a song. And I always was real interested in doing something like, and I wasn't interested in film for some reason. I was wanting that static image to do something that moved. And I think the music was put there to help it move, and you know. So I did a whole kind of body of those works. And Juarez was kind of the end result, because Juarez was both songs and big drawings and constructions that came along at the same time. And it really was like a haunting to me, because it just came, you know, and I had no idea where it came from, why, whatever, but it just came, and it came, in a flood,
question.
You know.
It did? It just all,
yeah, a total flood.
The concept just came, built
over a period of time, and it, in kind of three sections, and it's still something that's not resolved for me. It's like, I don't think it's not about resolution, I don't think, you know. Because I've written screenplays, I've done theater pieces with it, I've done installations, but it's always around the story and around the music and around the images, you know? And it's just like a whirlwind that's always kind of happened, you know, when Juarez happens in my head, you know? And I've put one of those songs on every album I've done since Lubbock, at least one. Just because I had such little money to work with when I cut the original record, and
I wanted to investigate, see
what it would do with, you know, hacking it with this work with a band, you know, and whatever. So,
did you have anybody with you saying, "Yeah, man, you got to do this. This is a great idea"? Or were you just all on your own? For those who haven't listened to
pretty
Juarez.
Much, I think along the way you hit people that, you know, that liked the drawings, and I would do shows and galleries, and there were people that liked the music. That's a big problem, though. It's a reality, is that you know, you talk to music people about your drawings or whatever, and they say, "What the fuck are you talking about?" You know, and then you talk to art people about music, and you know. What the fuck are you talking about, you know? So it's funny that the only people that kind of, oh, yeah, are artists and musicians, you know, who don't seem to have a problem with that kind of, but those kind of structures are, it's problematic, you know. Are you a musician? Are you an artist? What are you anyway? And you know, your response always is, what the fuck do you care? You know, this is what I do, and this is what it is, and you call it what you want.
I love that. That's why, to me, it seems like you're on an island with those characters and that whole concept for that album.
Yeah.
And to tie that into, you know, paintings and sculpture, it just must have been so alive in your head. Do you remember before it was recorded, before you got any of it real firmed up, what it was doing to you?
No, I never thought about it so much what it was doing to me. I was just always kind of in awe of the fact that it kept coming. And it was like nothing I seemed to have any control over. I would sit down and all these images would happen, and I would write songs and these images would appear. They were communicating with one another, you know. And it wasn't like something I could, you know, chart or to have any kind of, it was just something that was happening. And then after I look back what happened, that stuff was there, you know. So, and I still am kind of bewildered by it because, I know I've never thought of any of those characters in Juarez as being people. I've always thought of them as climates, as these kind of climates that were crashing into one another, you know, emotional climates and weather, like weather conditions kind of. So none of the drawings have any faces. There's no, and that's why maybe a reason I never thought about doing a film, because they would have to be actual people. And I didn't have a clue how they could be actual people, you know. I guess you could do it without any people, just have them kind of whispers. And,
I'm glad it's not a film. I'm glad it's just Terry Allen.
Yeah. I don't feel any loss the fact that it's not a film. And I've had a lot of people ask me, be interested in doing films in it. But
I mean, there's some great films out there, and everyone loves a good movie, but it seems to put everything in a nutshell, and I'd hate to see Juarez.
It does.
Encapsulated that way.
It locks it. It locks it into a certain kind of reality, and you can't get any other reality after that. You know? And I like the fact that it's just a sprawl that keeps kind of shifting and changing. Yeah.
For the time, and to have that inspiration, that influence, did you feel all alone and very insecure about the idea? How did you gain confidence in doing something that's still so obscure?
I think the thing itself doing it was company. You know, that was the company that was, because I didn't, as far as human company, there wasn't that much, you know. Joe Harvey always was there, you know, and has always been an encouragement. Even when she's not, she's been encouragement. She went through a lot of hoops just, you know, with me going in the studio and just working night and day on stuff. And
so even when you were in school, when y'all went out there, you two got an apartment together?
Yeah, we were married.
Didn't have any more roommates?
I went out to California for six months and worked in factories and stuff. And then at the end, I tried to save money, called her, and it proposed, and went back to Lubbock. We got married and drove immediately back to L.A. And that was in 62 that we got married. So, you know, we were all through the 60s together, and from then on. But yeah, it was an intense time for everybody, and it was intense. And one thing that was hard, I think, for both of us, because Joe Harvey got real interested in acting, and we had a radio show in L.A., and she was the, you know, one of the first female country DJs probably in the country. And I would program the show. It's called Rawhide and Roses, and it was every Sunday in Pasadena in the basement of this church, a station called KPPC. And KPPC was Pasadena Presbyterian Church. And it became a very popular kind of underground radio show in the late 60s. And so she got all caught up in wanting to be a movie star and all of that kind of stuff, and dealing with acting, and started to write some of her stuff. But she, more than anything, we both also wanted kids, you know. And so Bucca and Bale came along in the late 60s, around that same period of time. So that was a little bit of collision with us, of like, you know. And so we solved it by leaving L.A. and going to Lubbock for like 5 months. And then I got a teaching job in Berkeley in 1970 and a guest artist gig. And we moved back to California. But I think...
So you never really went on the road with that music?
I was on the road, but I was on the road doing the music like in an art context where I would go to schools or go to museums or galleries or whatever and show slides or show the actual work and play the songs with it. So it was like I would accompany my own stuff in that sense, you know. So it wasn't like I was, you know, with a record company or anything like that. The first Juarez was originally... a suite of six prints, lithographs, that I did in Chicago. And the reason that that happened is this guy came to see one of these presentations I did and saw the images and then listened to it. I was playing a tape of the songs that went with the images. And he said, well, let's do a record in a suite of prints. And I said, yeah, okay. And so we did, and that's how the record came about. I went to... traded drawings for the, got my cousin who was a road manager for the Jefferson Airplane at the time, got him to produce it and traded him drawings and prints, the engineer, and we recorded at Wally Hyder's where the airplane had their own, or actually the Starship at that time, had their own room in the Wally Hyder studio. And we recorded at 9 in the morning, nine and 10 up till about 11 when the band would start filtering in, because it was the only time that they were there all night and all afternoon and all night. So we only had the morning. So it's a horrible time to record anything. But we'd stay up all night, so we'd make sure we were really tired before we went in to record, you know, so we felt like we were had been at it all night. And... that's how that was recorded, and it was released on this little. First it was no label. We just did 50 boxes of the prints with records in them, LPs in them, and then printed 500 more on top of that to sell at gigs or whatever I was doing, and then we formed our own record company before Lubbock to do Lubbock, and it was Fate Records, and that's where I did most of my initial stuff was on my own label. Up to until I got in Sugar Hill.
That was unheard of back then.
Well, it was pretty much unheard of, and it was unheard of because it was totally stupid. You know, because we had no way of distributing anything. We knew nothing about the business. All we did, we knew what it cost to press something and what we should sell them for, you know. And so all of the stuff that we made went right back into the repressings or whatever, but it was, you know, it was a slow rolling thing, but it wasn't about that. It wasn't about, you know, it wasn't about a market. I didn't, you know,
I would imagine like you mentioned in galleries and colleges, getting the type of response and understanding for what you were doing.
It was pretty sparse.
In bars and stuff, you would have just been frustrated. You got to listen to that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, and I played a few bars and whatever, but I never thought about it as a place for what I was doing at that time. You know, there was other...
That's really insightful, Terry.
Well, I, you know, it's in a sense, it's funny because like when I would get with Guy and get with people that my peers of, you know, songwriters and people like that, there's an element I have always felt like that I don't fit with this kind of situation, you know, even though I love these people and I love what they do and have no bones about their lives or anything. But what I do and what I've done with my stuff seems so alien to what, you know, their expectations were, it seems to me like. And that's changed a little over time because I think one thing I know about musicians is that all of them are curious about something else. I don't know too many musicians that, like Guy painted, you know, Butch takes photographs, Joe has always written and drawn. And so there's always kind of something to get it out of you and put it out where you can look at it, whether it's a song or picture or whatever. So that's a common denominator, I think, you know. But yeah, I just, what I'm saying, I just kind of came at it from another angle. And that doesn't mean anything one way or the other. It's just, that's the reality of it.
I love that you had enough confidence and belief in what you're doing that you didn't need like musical acclaim to back it up, that you, it was part of a bigger artistic picture you had in your head and you were devoted to. It feels like to me that right now is the perfect time for Juarez and Lubbock on Everything to be really
well, they were reissued
understood and appreciated,
yeah,
fully. Like it took us all a long time to catch up to what you were doing, and at least have a broad enough. Okay, so back then you were from out there, others were from over here.
Yeah,
there wasn't this giant overlap where you could look into a place,
yeah,
and get to understand it before you even went there.
Yeah,
and we packed ourselves so tightly into all these spaces that we occupy now. People are looking out towards Lubbock and West Texas. Marfa's a perfect example,
yeah,
of this hotbed of creativity and coolness out in the middle of West Texas. Like,
I think they're having
to drive the country you grew up in, and yeah, they're finally getting a glimpse of some of those colors, that landscape, meeting people at gas stations on the way, and starting to understand the characters in your stories. And
I think too, though, it's changing so fast. Just the tactile nature of things, you know, the idea of touching a record, touching a CD, touching a tape, physically putting it, you know, where now it's podcasts or it's whatever.
Here we are.
Yeah. Now it's streaming or it's this, but it's the idea, which, you know, of a continuity, of like a group of songs or a group of ideas becoming one thing and presented it really as one thing, like side A, side B, but it's all one thing. And that's what's always interested me, is like how a story unfolds, how something, you know, that where you take the time to investigate what's going on with different aspects of it. And it's kind of get lost now, I think, because just of the technology. You know, people will grab one song and it'll be a hit song for a week, and then they go to the next one or whatever. But it's not about an exploration into something and really taking the time to how you, you know, absorb something or think about it and whatever. So I think there's a little return because of the whole LP thing of you know, that of it coming back to a certain degree. And I know that, you know, the reissues of Juarez and reissues of Lubbock and these new one that I'm getting ready to do, which are, you know, it's really going to push it because it's stories, you know, and it's people telling stories. And I don't have no idea how the response will be. And I've never had any idea what people's response will be to what I do, you know.
That hadn't been a motivator for you.
No, it really hasn't. And I've always thought, too, that if you try to cater to what you think people will think, you're really catering to the lowest common denominator in yourself, you know, because you need to follow what that thing is that's moving you toward whatever it is you're going to make, you know. And you come much closer to touching somebody else if you're true to yourself, I think, when they expose, than if you try to cater to them, you know.
100%.
Yeah.
What would drive you, like, let's say, well, first off, tell us about the new project and what's involved in that.
The stories?
Yeah, go ahead and talk. Scott.
Is that Scott?
Yeah, give me a second. So I want to.
Yeah, I'm going to take a break.
Sorry, wait for your voice to knock.
Have you been out there a while?
Yeah.
Lay back. Enjoy.
Well, the new project is another reissue of an old work. But I was invited in the early 90s to the Brooklyn Academy, actually early 90s, 86, by Margaret Jenkins Dance Company in San Francisco to do a piece with her. And I'd never worked with dancers, and I had no concept of what she does, and she had no concept of what I did. And we got together and liked each other and started talking about it. And so I had been working on this group of songs about Billy the Kid, but Billy the Kid as a pedal steel guitar player. And it was based very loosely on an actual guy named Wayne Gailey, who kind of roamed around Texas, New Mexico in the late 60s, early 70s, and was one of the first people that ever played rock and roll, pedal steel in a rock and roll context. And I remember Roxy Gordon, who was a friend of mine, told me about Wayne. And ironically, the first time I heard of Wayne Gailey was the first day we were recording Lubbock on Everything. Lloyd got a call that Wayne had OD'd in, I think, Reno or Vegas, and was dead. And Lloyd's told me what a great player he was. And I don't remember telling me where he saw him, but I remember the story of somehow he would be playing in a little bar in New Mexico, and there'd be just straight head country stuff, and then some girls would walk in, and he would just do a Hendrix takeoff, you know, and Lloyd said those takeoffs were phenomenal, you know, and it, so you kind of got a sense of where Lloyd was getting that, some of that psychedelic shit that was going on in his, you know, Lubbock redneck brain at the time. anyway, so I started writing just some songs and parts of songs about a steel player, Roman, New Mexico. And so when I got asked to do this thing with Margaret, I just sat down and wrote a script of the story of this person and the songs, and wrote the songs and whatever. And
this was in your studio in Santa Fe?
Yeah. This was in Fresno.
Oh, okay.
I was in Fresno.
Back in California.
I was still in California. And so I brought it to them, and then they asked me, well, do the sets and do the costumes and do the whole deal. So I had this, the set was a drive-in movie theater with a head frontal and rear projection where the dancers could kind of walk like the silhouettes on the screen, but they could also be, you know, live dancers. And then I told them, well, what you need to, the way this should be costumed is, if you can imagine going to Clovis, New Mexico in 1970 on a Saturday night about 2 a.m. and just steal everybody's clothes in the booth. You know, that's how you costume it. And, of course, nearly all of them weren't even born in 1970, you know.
Or haven't been to Clovis.
But so they did. Yeah, they never heard of Clovis. But anyway, so they did a lot of the costumes out at the thrift shops and stuff, you know. But then we performed it, and they performed it all over, you know. And it was real interesting because it was like working on Mars, you know. It's like, I'm sure for them and for me, you know. But at the same time, there was a rapport that we developed, and the piece was, you know, turned out really good. And then I recorded it. And Sugar Hill, when I was with Barry Poss, you know, had the nerve to just do it as a 30-minute piece, you know, which is a little over 30 minutes of just, it's like one track. And
so, how many takes?
Well, it was done like building a sculpture. Like, you know, I brought all these people into Lubbock, and Sharon Ely was in it, Joe Harvey was in it, Butch was in it. Had all these bands. I had two Navajos doing some stuff, different people doing readings. We had every surface in the studio was strips of tape with a note on it of what it was, and then we built it and put it together, and that became what it is. So it was tactile in that sense, you know, because I always did think of it like a sculpture, like we were kind of putting together a disassembled sculpture, putting it back together, you know, and building it. And so anyway, that's going to be reissued as an LP. It was only as a CD.
Oh, okay.
And then I did four radio shows for New American Radio that were played on NPR. The first one, I think, was called Torso Hell, which was done in late 80s. And then up through about 96, I think, the last one.
Were you narrating stories?
Yeah,
with music
I wrote these stories for radio, and Joe Harvey delivered them, and I wrote music for them and sound effects and everything.
Oh,
and
cool.
So they're like radio shows, but they're kind of like late radio shows, you know, made to curdle your blood, you know. So, but anyway.
And unless you were tuned in back then, you wouldn't have heard them anywhere else?
You wouldn't have heard them on anything but NPR.
Oh, cool. You know? When can we expect this to come out?
It's coming out in April. You know, we just finished mastering everything, remastering, and, you know, all the baloney.
Do you feel like there's a renaissance of your career musically happening right now? Do you get that energy? Has it always felt the same?
I never thought about, and this is the truth, I've never thought about having a career. I've always thought somewhere down the line you made a choice about how you were going to live your life, and that's what you do. That doesn't mean you're not going to have to deal with all the bullshit everybody else has to deal with, like making a living and eating and all that stuff. But I think you do make this choice, and that's just what you do in the dice roll however they and fall however they fall.
Is that harder to do now than it used to be, or is it all the same?
I don't know. You know, I think it was, I mean, for me, just because of, I think of the incredible vitality of the 60s and the changes that were happening so rapidly. Culturally, on every level, I think it was probably easier then to be, you know,
to get ignited,
to try to figure out what you were doing and what art was and where you fit within music or whatever.
Find inspiration that spoke to you.
Then now, yeah, there's something, you know, I kind of feel for young kids now that. Because I don't understand what their dilemma is. I don't understand how they're going to, you know. I know I did a guest artist at a university once where the art department just sucked. You know, the people had no feeling about anything that they were doing. But then I went to the computer animation area. And it was fantastic what they were doing, the energy and the images and, you know. So I think it always changes, you know, it's always, but I don't know how, you know, I don't know what those pressures are really.
Well, it may be even simpler than pressures. Like, what if you had an electronic tablet when you were a kid in Lubbock and it had thousands of games on it you could search and play? And
well, we were talking today about that, you know, prefabricated entertainment, you know, which I grew up in, there wasn't any. You invented your entertainment, you know. You go see a movie and then you would play the movie, you know. Everybody, all the neighbors would get together and dress up in costume and you'd play the movie.
Oh, really?
You know, but you were always looking for something to play, you know,
like you were saying with Jimmy and Joe and everyone sketching and writing and learning instruments, and those aren't instant gratification exercises. Those are dedicate yourself to the time it takes to learn chords and learn to play an instrument.
But it's also the advantage of boredom.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, because you have time and you have a space that you do. And I like Joe, you know, Joe said, like, learning guitar, I saved my life, you know, just because it was a doorway out, you know. And I think that's what a lot of people that, you know, maybe weren't conscious of it, but you were inventing your doorway, you know. And you were using whatever it was that moved you, you know, to kind of incorporate it into that doorway to get your ass out, you know. And some people didn't feel that way. I mean, a lot of people, they didn't want to leave, you know, or wanted to leave and didn't, or God helped the ones that were drafted and never came back that way.
Yeah. You
know? So. And that was a big one then, too, you know, the, just how many people were getting killed and people that you knew and people that were damaged by the war.
Same now, but it's like we don't even think about it. It's still going on.
Yeah, I know.
Longest running war in American history.
War,
yeah.
You know.
When did you learn to sculpt? When did you start sculpting?
When I moved to Santa Fe, really, is when I started doing bronze stuff. And there was a guy that owned a foundry there that kept dogging me and asking me if I'd come in and just kind of do something. And then I got an offer. They were doing a sculpture program, this City Core Plaza was inviting different artists to make proposals for their this new sculpture area that they were building around the huge, you know, 70-floor story building. And so I remember doing a drawing. They wanted you to work with a poet. And I asked this poet, who was a friend of mine named Philip Levine, who lived in Fresno. And Phil came out and we talked about all kinds of things that we, you know, thought might work together or whatever, and didn't come up with really. We thought it would be great to have a washing machine in front of that laundered money in front of the Citicorp bank, you know. But that was about the only idea that we both liked. And then I got this idea of doing this businessman just sticking his head in a building.
What year was that?
That was 92, I think. And so I sent it to the woman who was the art person who was kind of coordinating all of the artists and poets and whatever. I sent it to Phil first, and he said, it's a great idea, let's do it, you know, and he was going to write a poem that went with it. And
I think so, it's stronger on its own.
Well, it's got a poem right.
I never read
he's
the poem.
He's been over in the wall, and the poem is right behind him on the ground. And so you have to basically get in the same position the guy's in to read the poem, you know. And so
is that still in place?
Yeah, it's still there. It's a permanent piece. It was actually at one point on the top 10 places to see in L.A. on the Gray Line tour. So it was right up there with the Pacific Ocean and Disneyland, you know. But anyway.
That had a tremendous effect on me. When I first glimpsed at it.
Corporate head, yeah.
I'd just gotten out of college, UT. Around 92 is when I graduated.
Yeah.
I was floundering around, not thinking of what I was supposed to do. You've defined it so perfectly for me. Knowing you and being close to your family now for 20 plus years, it's just little tidbits, man, that you've delivered me that have given me extreme confidence and sort of being lost and okay with that process of elimination for me. When I the first thing I said to myself when I saw that piece was, fuck, like that's art. And you know, like from a layman's terminology, yeah. I can't define art and why it seems like art, but I can look at a piece and feel pretty confident. And when I say art, I take that very seriously.
Yeah.
And when I say, like, and then I'll look at a painting or anything. That's fucking bullshit. Now, I could be wrong multiple times, but in your case, I haven't been. I said to myself, okay, well, whatever you've got to do not to be that son of a bitch.
Yeah, that's kind of the way I felt.
And he couldn't be bent over more in that posture.
Yeah.
And ruined by his decisions than he is standing there with that briefcase.
But I'll tell you something funny about that too, is like, I remember after it was installed, the day we installed it, and it's like people always, when something it appears in a place that they're not used to ever seeing it, you know, they pass by it all the time and all of a sudden there's something new there, their reaction is usually negative, you know. But in this case, it was so bizarre because you'd see guys walking with the briefcase and they'd stop and they'd look and relate to it. I mean, you could, you know, but I also related to it because sticking your head in a building or sticking your head up your own ass or whatever, you know, I'm as much that guy as anybody else. So, and, you know, I think that's where it came from.
Did everyone in that building quit their job the next day?
No, you know what? It became this kind of fetish object for a lot of the women in the building would go, and still do, pat him on the ass when they'd go into work and pat him on the ass when they come out. So there's no patina at all on it. It's like just shiny bronze. And then a lot of these bike messengers that would ride their bikes, they would park their bike front wheels right between his legs.
Between his legs.
and then pull it. So there's this sheen
inside
of
his knees
black
are
rubber
polished
inside of his legs, you know. And I like that. Yeah, you know, I like that.
It seems to me that he was overtaken by the daily grind.
Yeah.
That he couldn't have been more desensitized and soulless in that
soulless
daily march.
Mindless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what it meant to me.
That's what
on
that's
first
what it is.
Glance.
Yeah. Yeah.
And his shoulders are, it doesn't look headless. It looks like he's been over so far and from the weight that he put on himself.
Yeah.
That
and the weight the world.
That he missed the doorway and ended up planting his head into the granite of the,
what
that's a beautiful piece. And that
thanks, JT.
That is just like, man, it's, I'm just so proud. I'm so proud to know you and I'm proud of you. I'm proud of what you've done with your art and with your life and where
thanks,
you come
JT.
From. I really am. We need you.
Yeah.
So what a prick move was it for Guy to insist that you do something with his ashes? Were you honored or did you think, you cocksucker?
I thought you cocksucker.
I can imagine.
No, I guess it was because it was kind of a shock when it became real, you know, because we had jived each other about it before then. But, you know, I never kind of took it serious, and I don't know that he did. But he was actually serious about it because Rodney said he talked about it a lot, that's what he wanted to happen. And I remember
I viewed it as his greatest achievement was tricking you into that.
Yeah, that he had died, and he said, okay, you're next. It's coming your way, you know.
So for clarification, Guy Clark insisted after being cremated that Terry Allen incorporate his ashes into art.
Into a sculpture, yeah.
You feel like talking at all about what you've done with that, or you want to keep it a surprise?
No, I'll talk about it. You know, I told you earlier that it was, you know, he had mentioned that to me several years, you know, off and on, that wouldn't it be cool to have my ashes in this piece or that piece or whatever, and I want you to do, you know, put my ashes in the sculpture. And, you know, I'm just like, fuck you, you know. And finally, I just told him, I said, I'm going to do a goat. I'm going to do a bronze goat and shove your ashes up its ass. And he always looked at me and would say, perfect. You know?
So you could have made
that
it.
That was a kind of baloney, you know.
You could have made it
so
easy on yourself.
Yeah, so I always had an out. But then when he died and it became real, it was – I just figured, you asshole, you know, you did it, you know, and now I've got to deal with it. And I was honored, and I was nervous about it, and, you know, I wanted to do something that I felt he would feel good about, but at the same time, pissed off that he put me in a position to do that, you know. And it was like a typical guy situation, you know. That's just kind of the way he dealt with everybody, you know. And it was kind of a little smirking revenge thing or whatever, you know. But anyway, I had been talking to him pretty much right up until he died. But about the last 3 or 4 years of his life, he became obsessed with the Windmill Museum in Lubbock. And every time he and Verlin were kind of playing around there close, they would go visit that museum. And if I don't know if you've ever been there, but that's a phenomenal museum.
I haven't.
You know, we'll go.
I will.
But it's got these trenches that have windmills in. It's a huge building, like a, you know, just like the Astrodome or something. It's a huge building. And windmills from all over the world, all kinds of windmills. But there were two nests, crow's nests, that he focused on. And they were built during the Dust Bowl, during the Depression. They were built out of barbed wire and baling wire. And that's all these crows evidently had access to. And so they built these beautiful objects. And Guy was, you know, infatuated with them and had started writing a song called the Caw Caw Blues. And it was about Heckle and Jekyll, and about, there were some lines about the nests and about the, you know, the barbed wire and all of that stuff. But it was kind of it wasn't his best song. And I think Rodney helped him finish it, you know. And I don't know what the changes since have been. I don't know if Rodney's changed it. But it wasn't about that. To me, every time I talked to him and we'd talk about it, I had worked on this song when we were down in Oaxaca together, and I'd come up the idea of this. Well, it was actually his idea of a song called "The Wrong Blue," and so I was working on that, and it was falling apart, and he was working on "Caw Caw Blues," and we'd talk on the phone about how fucked up our songs were, you know, and what we could do and whatever, to me, you know, toward the end especially, and when he was so really adamant about talking, the way he talked about this song, it wasn't about the song. It was about something really much deeper than that. It was about him dying. It was about what was happening to him physically, what was going on with his, and it was about songwriting. It was about making something out of nothing. It was about all of these things that I think were happening to him at the time he was thinking about. So when he died, and there was a wake in Nashville, and then a bunch of people put his ashes on a bus and came in a bus and to Santa Fe. And we had another wake at our place. And I called a bunch of people like Lyle and Joe and Robert Earl. They all came, drove in. And we had a really interesting night. I put the ashes, and there was a Jim McGuire done a photograph of Guy, and we had his boots and made a little altar kind of with some candles in the front room. And we ordered green chili chicken enchiladas, which Guy was his favorite thing to eat there, and when he came to visit. And then we all ended up in the front room, just kind of in mass, went in there, and no one said a word, just looked at at his ashes. And then one by one, people started telling stories, you know, and until that kind of ran its course. And then we all went outside, and we had played no music or anything. Nobody played any music. And then I told Steve Earle, I said, Steve, why don't you get a guitar and we'll just... And so we sat around this cauldron full of, you know, with fire in it. And it was chilly. It was in May, but it was chilly at night. And so Steve said, let's everybody do a song God would want us to do, you know. And we took turns singing songs, you know, and lasted about 3 or 4 hours. And then it was over, you know, and everybody left the next day. So
perfect.
And so anyway, I've had this idea of doing a crow or doing a nest or whatever. And I'd been going to Uncommon Objects, which is a store in Austin, great junk store. And there was a stuffed crow in there, and every time I would go in there, I would go in it to make sure it was still there. I should probably buy that, you know, but I didn't do it. But I kept going back, and finally I said, you know, fuck it, I'm going to buy it.
Let's get this shit over with.
Yeah. I just said this is doing something, so it must mean something because it keeps happening to me every time I see it. And so I got it. And there's a foundry that I've been working with in Bastrop, Texas, and so I took it to them, and they did a 3D scan of it and blew it up a little bigger than a raven, and we cast it when the cauldron, when it was molten bronze, I put a quarter of the ashes threw it in the molten bronze. So when the crow was cast, its body was ash. You know, you can see the ashes all through it. And then the three quarters left, I opened up the crow and put the rest of the ashes inside, so it became an urn. And I told you earlier, I should have opened up its ass and shoved those ashes in there, but we didn't. We opened its chest up. And I remember Verlin saying, God, you should have shoved it up its ass. But anyway, so that's kind of the story. It's called Call Blues.
Oh, man. So, any idea where it's going to live?
No, I don't.
Hang on to it for a while.
It's going to live somewhere that he wants it to be, and
that's got to be a permanent installation in the right museum.
Or it needs to stay with you. I don't know. You know, I don't know yet.
It's a beautiful, ragged, weathered, well-traveled crow.
Really good, and you know.
And ashes.
And it reminds me of him.
It's got one
of those smirks that you know that he always had.
Our ashes aren't powdery. They're like sand.
They're like grains.
I know that from fondling my dad's ashes.
Yeah.
And I was amazed at how bony they are. It's like,
that's what they're like. They're like a
crushed
bone.
Oyster shell.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So
I was going to trick it into somebody's food, but they'd have noticed it. It's like sand.
Yeah, break a teeth.
Is it easier for you now these days to wander out to your studio and paint or start a song?
Well, I've been traveling so much. Scott and I were talking about that the other day. I've been traveling so much that I haven't had 2 weeks straight in my studio for over a year, and that's been driving me a little nuts. So I'm shutting it down and just, you know.
Been traveling, playing music.
Traveling, playing music, but I've been doing, the Texas Tech has taken Joe Harvey and our archives, and they've been out there. You know, we've been boxing stuff, going through stuff, that's a whole other brand of hell, you know. But getting stuff out of there, which has been, it's been great and it's been hard, you know. But so that's been going on all year, you know. And then, I've been playing, but I've also, you know, I was in Austin a long time working on that car piece, the Road Angel piece, that Laguna Gloria. And then I reprogrammed the songs on it, got a whole new group of people, you know, to add to it last year. This year, I just haven't had time to do it, but I'm going to do it again next year, you know. So they build up a real archive of just a of Texas music mainly, but it's a lot of other stuff on it too, you know.
Did I hear you guys are thinking about a permanent move to Austin?
No, we got a place there, but it's not. It's Joe Harvey's allergic, has allergies in the spring in Santa Fe, so we're going to spend most of the time. She is for sure, you know.
She's probably got to outrun it from both places. That's just the juniper.
Somehow it doesn't bother her. It doesn't bother her in Austin. Hmm. You know, the cedar fever stuff doesn't seem to, not like it does Santa Fe. So. Anyway, that's kind of dictating the time we spent there. And then I've been playing a lot there. You know, like last year I played a lot in Austin.
What's left to do? What's really burning inside of you?
We just got asked to do these. I built two theater pieces in Santa Fe, one called Dugout and one called Ghost Ship Rodez. They were big, large bodies of work, but the theater elements were... We did the first kind of run-throughs and trials of them at the Lenzic Theater, and we had a really good friend who was a director there and had this program called Under Construction, which a lot of local people did pieces that they were working on. So he's left the Lenzic, but he's now in San Francisco at the Presidio Theater. And so he called the other day and wants us to do anything that we want to do there. And so I've been working on these little bitty short kind of knife wound plays that I thought would be really good to try to do. And so I've started writing those, and I also go with a group of drawings that I'm working on. So I'm...
How do you prioritize that? Just based on the level of motivation and inspiration you're feeling towards each? Just ebb and flow between...
Yeah, I don't know if I prioritize.
Painting, sculpting, music.
I go to
music.
My studio every day. Doesn't mean I'm productive every day or anything, but I found out I have to be a Nazi with myself to just get things done. And if I'm in there long enough, sooner or later I start doing something, you know. And so that's just kind of how I work. But I've always worked that way, you know. And I think you generate your own curiosity kind of that way.
Well, I'm excited to see the film tonight. I haven't seen any of the stuff with you and Ryan Bingham that Yeti's doing. And we're here in Nashville to go look at Yeti films tonight.
To watch ourselves.
And then get to enjoy myself.
Yetified.
With you and Joe Harvey. Yeah. I don't get to see you guys enough.
And Scott.
And Scotty Ballou. Thanks, man. You're really something for Texas and Americans to be very proud of.
I'm proud of you, pal.
Thanks, amigo.
You know that.
I do.
Yeah.
I do. I could talk for another hour about what it means to me, but.
Well, let's don't.
Good to see you, amigo. Let's go spend some time.
Yeah, same here.
Cheers.
Thanks again for listening to Drifting, presented by Yeti and hosted by me, JT Van Zandt. To listen to more episodes, visit yeti.com or search Drifting on iTunes.